the Bible in our groups and even the small groups of husbands and wives and family. And so it's going to be quite a thing. More information will be coming on that. But today we also celebrate the completion of things when it comes to some of our discipling classes. And I want to invite Pastor Frank and you coming up too, Zelma. And you're coming up too, Don, the whole crew. Anybody else want to come on up? Because we welcome you all.
We do need Beth. You'll come up, Beth, please. And we need Leonard. And we need Ron. Can you come up, Ron? And Brian? Where's Brian Larkey? Brian, where are you? Oh, there he is. Okay, I'm sorry. I'm looking the wrong way. Right church, wrong pew, huh, Brian? And Carnell. Where are you, Carnell? There he is. Oh, you knew. Good for you. All right. These people, well, let's see. Three of these people have... I'll give you these back, have completed 201, and we have three people that have completed 101, and one of them is not here today. Mario is not here, but he has completed that. And so I guess you ought to start with one, huh? So we'll start with the 101. So who would that be? Beth? Bless her heart. It's a certificate of completion. And Leonard, or Carnell, and Leonard. Great. Did he get one? Did you get, okay, ready. I want to say this. These people don't just teach a class. They are disciplers. They are committed to help these people grow in Jesus Christ. And every week, they pour themselves into their lives. And that's what it's about. It's not just teaching some class. It's about helping people to grow. And I love it when I'm teaching these studies in Christian living, when I see a light go on in their head. It's like, whoa, they got it. Look at that. Whoa, that's really exciting. And you've had that experience, haven't you?
Oh, yes.
All right. So go ahead. Who you got here?
Brian. And... Carnell and Ron. I've enjoyed having all of you in my class. The class that I taught is What We Believe. And it's all of the beliefs and the faiths of the Wesleyan Church. And I really enjoyed teaching it. And you guys... Yeah, right. You guys have been a blessing to me. You really have. It does me good to see you every Sunday morning in there. And even when I'm not there, you're there.
So. Don's had a couple bumps in the road, but they have been kind along the way. Now, this is how it works. The people who are in 201, they get to come to 301 with me. Okay, they've already got an invitation, and the people who are in 101 get to go at 201 with Don, and we already have some people signed up, Elizabeth and who else, Alma, signed up for 101, so we're off and running. We just keep this going. We want to help people grow. That's the whole commitment to it. Thanks so much, guys, and thank you, leaders, for helping us out in this.
Well, I can't think of a more appropriate song than the one that we're about to sing. If you could stand with us, we're going to sing Shout to Our Lord.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your might. strength, let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord all the earth, let us sing, power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength, let every breath in all that I am never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord all the earth, let us sing, power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the word of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. In nothing compares to the promise I have. In nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Nothing compares to that promise of our Lord. The next song we're going to sing is Better Is One Day. Better is one day in his house and his courts and in God's presence than any other day. So let's sing that and let's lift our Lord up today.
How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty, for my soul longs and even faints for you. For here my heart is satisfied within your presence. I seek beneath the shadow of your wings. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere, than thousands elsewhere. One thing I ask and I should see, to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. One thing I ask and I would see, to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, better is one day in your court than thousands elsewhere. My heart and flesh cry out for you, the living God. Your spirit's water tore my soul. I've tasted and I've seen. Come once, come into me. I will draw near to you. I will draw near to you. And to you. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Than thousands elsewhere.
We're just going to take a couple minutes. We're going to open up the altar for a time of prayer. We're going to meet with our Lord today. So if God's been speaking to you this week and you just have some burdens that you've been carrying, we'd ask that you'd come and you lay those at your Lord's feet this morning. And again, if he's been working out answers to prayer and he's just been working and ministering in your life, then we'd ask that you'd come and be obedient to that and just give him the praise and glory he deserves. So if God's leading you, we'd ask that you'd come forward at this time.
God Almighty,
we can pray. We're thankful we can come before you right now in this place at this moment. We're thankful, God, for all that you do. And you know this song says, hearts are mended. Hearts are mended. You are the one who restores. You are the one who repairs. You are the one who strengthens and prepares us for whatever has to be done in our lives. Thank you, God, for that. And you see your people today, and our heart is filled with gratitude for who you are. And you see your people have come here to the altar rail. They've not come to a piece of wood, Lord God. They've come to you, Almighty Living God, seeking your face. And they do so reverently, with a heart open for your direction and for your touch. Lord God, where there's a need for repair when it comes to the way folks have been living, God, or whatever it might be, Lord God, we ask for forgiveness, all of us, for where we have done the wrong things in our lives. We know the expectations from you for your children are to do the right things. And so we're here today to come into agreement with you once again that we will always do the right thing. We will give it all that we've got. We know, Lord, we don't have to accomplish anything apart from you, that you are the one who gives us strength, that you are the one who leads, that you are the one who does whatever needs to be done in our life. We simply need to submit to you this morning. And we all throughout the auditorium are doing that today. We submit to you, God. There may be some that are just sorrowful today because of things that have been going on in their life. And they feel sorrowful, Lord God. We ask, Lord, that you'd encourage them right now with your Holy Spirit. You touch them. May they receive the encouragement they need. Lord God, we live in a very busy world and difficult world with difficult times. You know the hearts of your people. There may be some that are having physical problems that need a touch from you, Lord God, and we know our bodies grow older and all that, but Father, you have said that we're to bring everything to you. And so, where there's a physical need this morning, we pray, God, for your touch to meet that physical need. We pray, God, for healing. We know you're a God who heals. We believe in that. It's true. According to your word, it's true. According to our life and what we have seen you do already, it is true. Although we look back at what you've accomplished, we look forward to what you have in mind for the future. So God, even as we pray now, as we seek your face, we do so knowing that we need you to lead and guide us into the time that is ahead of us. Please, God, give us what we need every day. Please, God. Lord, we're thankful again that we can pray. And if there's someone in the auditorium today that is making their first step forward toward you, their first real commitment in their life toward you, God, oh, God, touch their hearts and let them know that this is the way to go. So, Lord, again, whatever goes on here needs to bring you the glory and the honor, no matter what. Every one of our lives, thank you for knowing us by name. Thank you, God, for knowing who we are and what is needed. Even when we don't necessarily know specifically, you do. You do, the all-knowing God. So we do love you and ask that you continue with us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
In the
seated. I'd ask that our ushers would come forward at this time. will accept this morning's offerings. We thank you for your faithfulness and giving. God continues to do great things through this church and through the food bank ministry and through the other ministries of the church. We just thank you for that. It wouldn't be possible without your faithful giving. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for meeting with us this morning, Lord. We thank you for your presence being here. Even though there's a lot of snow outside, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for being on this planet. We thank you for being in Michigan and being here with you this morning. We just ask that you would take our offerings today, Lord. We just ask that you would use them. Use them to build your kingdom, Lord. Use them to glorify you. Use them to win more souls for Christ. We ask that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Flint First, we're very blessed to have men and women that go into the ministry over the years. We're always good to, we're always glad to be able to be thrilled with their success and their future. We have ministerial students even now that are associated with our church, and you're going to hear from one this morning. He's a great guy. You know, Jonathan Kingan and his wife. And their three beautiful children are part of our fellowship here, the members here in the church. And Jonathan's been called into ministry. He's studying for the ministry. For some of you that may never have heard him before speak, he speaks usually every other Wednesday night at our life service. And I really look forward to having him here this morning to share with you. Jonathan King, come on up, my brother. God bless you. Give him a good hand, would you please? Let the Lord bless you, brother.
All work, no play may have made Jack a dull boy, but all work, no guy has left Jack with a lost soul. But he's moving on full steam. He's chasing the American dream. He's gonna give his family a finer thing. Not this time, son. I've no time to waste. Maybe tomorrow I'll have time to play. Slips into his new BMW and drops farther and toys wins. But if it loses its soul, what has it gained in the end? I'll take a shack on a rock over a castle.
Everybody, we are all just people. We're all just people, and it's all about God. The last few minutes, God rang through my mind. I was so focused on so many things. And I prayed with Pastor Tom earlier. And in his prayer, he reminded me that it's all about God. How did I show up to church so focused on church and that smacked me in the face? Thank you for that, God. Thank you for praying with me, Pastor Tom. We're all people, and it's all about God. We're all just people. It's all about God. What kingdom are we building today? What are we so focused on? What are we so concerned about? First Corinthians chapter 3, don't worry about turning to it unless you want to. What after all is Apollos and what is Paul? Only servants through whom you came to believe. As the Lord has assigned to each his task, I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God made it grow. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow. The man who plants and the man who waters have one purpose, and each will be rewarded according to his own labor. For we are all God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God is building. By the grace God has given me, I laid a foundation as an expert builder, and someone else is building on it. But each one should be careful how he builds, for no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. If any man builds on this foundation using gold, silver, costly diamonds, wood, hay, or straw, his work will be shown for what it is. Because the day will bring it to light, and it will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each man's work. If what he builds survives, he will receive his reward. If it is burned up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but only as one escaping through the flames. I was thinking about us as a family, us as a church, and how we all have our job, and so many of us do such a great job and make this service happen today and throughout the week, the things that go on. And the fact that everyone does have a job. And just kind of hypothetically, I don't know a Fred, so I'm going to say Fred. Fred comes into church. Fred meets a lot of very interesting people, very nice, very friendly, and he enjoys the service, and he can't wait till next service next week. He comes back, he meets more people, all of them very friendly. They all take time, talk to him, pray with him, whatever he needs. He's very encouraged when he goes home. Time goes on, he gets saved. He gets baptized, he's inviting his friends. They're experiencing the same thing because they see a life change in their friend Fred, and the same thing is happening with them. In that process, Fred had a seed planted throughout conversations, throughout the service. He was watered, God made him grow. The job got done. And the job's not over. He needs continued watering to continue to grow. If any of us go any time without food or water, we're not going to be much good for anything. We're going to start to starve and just be unhealthy. So we all need a continuance of water to continue to grow. And as I stated before, it takes a team. If we have a few people that will do a few things, we can function. But for somebody to come into a church that's new, they come in the door and they'll meet that few people that will do something, that will invest in that person. Well, they still need food and water. They're still looking for that friend that they made. So the next new person that comes in, that person's occupied. Somebody needs to step up into that person's place and be the next smiling face, be the next conversation, be the next person that's willing to pray and go on from there. We're all at different points in our lives. Unsaved, saved, freshly saved. We need water, we need food, we need to grow. We don't necessarily need to teach right now. We're growing. We're growing so that when we mature, we can start to teach in some way, shape, or form. Not everybody's a teacher, a pastor, per se. There's so many things that go on. The guys that do sound are awesome. Very willing to help, and they're all ducking their heads now, but that's cool. The praise team is awesome. It all comes together as a family, which is what we are. As Christians, we are a family. We're a team, and it all works well. The scary thing to me about the process is if somebody gets saved and that's where they stop, it's just as water. If water keeps moving, if water goes down a mountain stream, it stays fresh all the way down. If it stops in a puddle, in a swamp, if anywhere it stops for any period of time, it'll become stagnant. And after a while, nothing good can grow in it, nothing of any kind of good value. If I come into service and I get fed and I go home and I come in and I get fed and I go home and that's what I do, I'm not going to be good for anything. I'm going to become stagnant. Even physically, our bodies, we need to do some kind of work. We need to move somehow. We can't just stop what we're doing. That'll make us unhealthy, and pretty soon we physically won't be able to do any kind of good work because our body's not conditioned for it. We can't handle it. We're out of shape. And so to be effective, we have to keep moving. Of course, we need a rest, but if we get too much rest, you wake up with all kinds of aches and pains and don't want to move. Spiritually, we're the same way. Like I said, we can come in and get fed. If we just keep getting fed, then what? We come in and get fed, and what we've learned from the service, from what we've been taught, from the sermons, from the music, what God's given us, we can turn around what we've learned and give it to somebody else, give somebody else a piece of that. And that keeps the water moving. That keeps us fresh. That instead of us just being saturated and becoming stagnant, that keeps it going. God keeps us alive that way spiritually. like I said, as a team, we're all teaching in some way. We're all at some level. And if we have kids, this rings so true. I've seen it so many times with my own that the things that I do teach them so much more than the things that I tell them. My daughter Madison, last night, the kids were playing, and I was working on this, and she said, "Dad, how long are you going to walk in circles in the kitchen?" I don't know, honey. We'll play in a minute. I'm working on my sermon notes. She knows from the circles I was walking in the kitchen and that I said sermon notes that I was taking it seriously. She knows it's important to me. I could have sat her down and said, "I'm going to take this really serious. This is really important to me." But if I don't show her that, it's not going to mean the same thing. It's neat the things that we get to teach them just by what we do, because they watch everything we do and they want to know why we're doing what we do. Dad, why do we give money to the church? And some of these questions I know the answers to, but I think it's not a complicated answer. I've never point blank been asked that by a 5-year-old or however old she was when she first asked me this question. But I got to rethink about it from another point of view. It's our way of saying thank you, God, for what we have. And He wants this much back, so this is what I give Him back. And I trust, because I know God loves me and He's taking care of me, and that's why I have what I have, that I'm not going to be without now that I gave Him what He wanted. I'm going to have enough to do what I need. Why do we close our eyes when we pray? We're just thinking about God. We're not looking around at everything else that's going on. We're just thinking about God. Why do we go to church? Because it's a really cool support group. Because we get to hang out with God. Because the praise team helps us connect with God. Because the pastor tells us all about God. Because we learn. Because it's good for us. The work that I invest into that will be tested, and that day scares me, but it will be. And so I need to invest in more than a castle of sand. We have Jesus Christ, the foundation, and how I build on it will be shown for what it is when that day comes. I can hurry up and throw up sand, straw, hay. And all right, I have a house, I have a castle, my kid's all set to go. Obviously, that's not going to last. If I take every opportunity to slow down from the busyness of everything and answer the questions, that I can say, because that's the way God wants it. Because that's the way God wants it. If I say that all the time, that's not a whole lot of investment for me. It'll ring unimportant to them. So I get to build on my family, on my kids every day, just in the things that I say, just how I answer their questions, just how they see me take things important or not. I had a class here recently. I think it was in May. I don't remember. But the class was a good class. It was a church history class. And we talked about life cycles of churches, families, and things like that. And this was a span of over several hundred years. The point I'm bringing out is that there's lifespans of churches and cycles on how they grow and fall. And there's life cycles of families and how they grow and fall as well. And a basic, it's not cookie cutter. Not every family is the same. Not everybody is the same. A person gets saved, they are changed in an awesome way. Now, depending on their personality, they might be screaming hallelujah, or they just might be filled with tears and happiness. But they get saved, and it is a life-changing experience. and they go to church every time the doors are open. They take what they've learned home to their family, and now their family is in church every time the doors are open. Their family sees how serious and important this is to them, and they're all learning and they're growing. They're pillars in the church. And the parents of that family move on, and the kids are in church, and not taken quite as seriously, but they're in church. Maybe not necessarily every Sunday or every time the doors are open, but they're in church. And eventually that set of parents move on. Now we're down to the grandkids that are grown and they're in church. At least a couple times, a few times a year, definitely on Christmas and Easter, but they're in church and they believe in God. And they tell their kids that God's good and that we should pray and that we should read the Bible, and it's not taken quite as seriously. And then now you move on down the line and you see where that goes, and eventually it fades out. And it was all laid out in front of us and into a kind of a scary cycle that was all done by research and records that were studied, and they put it all out. And everybody kind of did the same thing. Okay, my great-grandfather, and now, and I'm right, oh wow. My grandparents were the beginning of that. And so I could see and I could relate to that cycle. I thought, all right, my grandparents, well, my grandpa was a pastor, and my dad, we were, you know, probably because he was a pastor, we were in church every Sunday. And it doesn't quite exactly identically line up, but I can see how, in myself and my sisters, how the seriousness of the level of dedication to going to church and to learning about God and self-discipline and reading the Bible and praying, how that tapers down. And I think, okay, so now myself, I'm the generation that I need to step it up, and I need to take it more seriously, and I need to make sure that my kids see how serious I am about this. And I'm not to step up and put on a show. I'm not a puppet, and I'm not going to do that, because they're going to see right through that anyway. Of course, I need to talk to them about it, and I need to pray with them and all those things, but they need to see that it's really bad weather, but we're going to church, you guys. It's all right. It's freezing cold out, and we're all really tired, but we're going to church. After one person has moved on, another person fills in. Not that the one person is dying, not that the one person fell away from God and left, but it's a natural thing for people to move from one spot to another, inside of a church, to another church, whatever it is. And a cycle in church that we talked about is that a generation will grow and they keep the jobs they have, and they didn't not necessarily train their replacements, but train the people behind them, and the people behind them are used to, they got it taken care of, I'm going to church. And it's a cycle on both ends that is hard to break out of. There's a saying, you got roped into that. Has anybody ever said, I've got roped into that, when they took over anything? All right, I've been roped into it. And I realized for myself that maybe I shouldn't look at it as roped into it. Yeah, I might have to do it for the next 75 years, but it's something for the church. I'm teaching somebody, I'm helping with something, because if I don't do whatever it is I'm doing that I don't necessarily like take an offering on Wednesday night, I really don't like doing that, but nobody else was able to do it, so I'm doing it. That frees somebody else that can do something else. And the water keeps moving and stays fresh. Ephesians chapter 4, It was he who gave to some to be apostles, some to be prophets, and some to be evangelists, some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will be no longer infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ. From him the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Churches everywhere. I'm not picking on anybody here because I'm still weakly impressed at what work people do here. Churches everywhere have an issue with my generation not being there. And I've heard people talk about what to do about it. I've met so many pastors, it's awesome because I can hear all these cool stories, but I hear this story, what do we do about it? And I recently heard, because I've thought and thought and thought on this, what do we do about it? How do we change this? And maybe I hadn't heard it before, but maybe it just rang loud. And when I did hear it recently, a man said, no, the young people need to step up and do something. We can do every trick in the book, and they still won't show up unless they show up. I thought, wow. Because that speaks to me just as loud as anybody else. Am I doing my job? And so I asked myself, what castle am I building? Is it going to get knocked over for the first storm that rolls through? Or is it going to stand strong? What kind of test is it going to have to stand up to? I don't know what that is, but I know that it's my job to prepare for it. I know that it's my job to prepare my family for it. We read the Bible and we pray. And we teach somebody else to read the Bible and pray. And we encourage somebody else. And then we read the Bible and we pray. And then we do whatever else is that we need to do to help the body of Christ, to help grow the kingdom. And we read the Bible and we pray. We all have time to read the Bible and pray. See, this life, we get one go around, and it's a really important go around. Since it's our one, we don't get a restart button. This is the one go around we have, and so we don't really have a choice. If I think about it, I have to read the Bible and pray, because now that I know that I have this one chance, and now that I know that it's all on me, like Pastor Tom spoke about last week, it's our responsibility for us. We are responsible for ourselves. If we have kids, we're responsible for them as well, but we have this one go around. We need to read the Bible and pray. We need to be a part of the body of Christ for our own good as well as the people that are not saved, to just do our part. When we go to work, we don't stand there and get paid for it. Just a minute ago, I read that we are all rewarded according to our own labor. So if we don't do anything, we're missing out on a reward. God always blesses us more than we can ever imagine or think that he would, and in a way that's way cooler than we would pick for ourselves, way better than we would pick for ourselves. I don't have time, I'm too busy, I'm too tired, and I don't really understand. I think are things that God has probably heard for hundreds, thousands of years, however long people have been around. But we all know better. I'm a slow reader, and I read most of the time. Sometimes Saturdays I don't get it. Sundays I'm fed whether I read myself or I'm at church. I'm not saying that's an exception, that's my schedule. Minimally 5 days a week I read one chapter. It's not a race. We don't have to read the Bible in a year. I read one chapter a day, and I pray on it, and I read. I read while I'm eating breakfast in the morning, because 90% of the time my kids are not up. Sometimes they are, and I put them back to bed, but I get it somehow. I found a long time ago that I feel so much less stressed when I read the Bible, and it's just because it's the living Word of God. Because I remember when I started reading just to say, help me, God, I am so stressed out at work right now. I went to lunch and I read the Bible, and I don't even remember what I read, but I remember thinking, this, okay, I kind of get it. But I realized after the fact, I really feel better. I really feel better. This is good stuff. This is good stuff. We take a bite of the cookie when we're told it's good stuff, right? This is good stuff. I would recommend starting with Matthew if you're going to start reading the Bible fresh. That's just my thought. That's where Jesus comes into play, and he teaches, and it's really cool to see what God does as Jesus on earth. Philippians chapter 2. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourself. Each of you should look not only to your own interest, but also to the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as Christ Jesus. This is such an awesome thing that we're given, and we are still the minority of people that get to freely worship God. And I don't know how long that'll last. I'm not saying that things are changing tomorrow, maybe in 100 years, but we are the minority of the history of the world that get to freely worship God without looking over our shoulder, without sneaking in the door, and without having to be very quiet so that nobody hears us talk about it out of fear of our own lives. And we get one go around to make the best of it. See, God's on our team. That's really awesome. God shows up when we get together. God shows up. God's with us when we want him to be, when we ask him to be. That's really awesome. God was with David when he took out Goliath. David stood by himself in the physical, but with God in the supernatural. And Goliath was taken down with no problem at all. We are all standing next to the Almighty when we want to be. And when we don't want to be, that's a scary day. We're on the winning team. We're on the winning team. We are on the winning team. All right. We are on the winning team. And we get to share that with the world. We get to show that to our families. We get to learn that ourselves. We are on the winning team. We get to share that with our families. We get to share that with our friends. We get to step into a position that somebody has moved on from and be part of the team, part of the working a team to build the body of Christ.